Welcome back. Hey boy, do we have the agenda today. So recently, much to my surprise, other developers have contributed Crazyhouse variant code to my Stockfish AI. However, it's still very much in a pre-alpha state in that it crashes regularly. So I spent some time this morning looking into it and found that there's a thing called a smash stacker, a stack smasher, which is in effect here, basically meaning that the program is reading and writing to its own runtime stack in a way that's not how it's supposed to be reading and writing from its address space. And that gets really advanced. If you have questions about it, let me know. I'll try to remember to mention it later. But effectively what it means is that the program is going beyond the bounds of the memory that you would normally expect it to access. However, it does so without triggering a segmentation fault. A segmentation fault would be when the program tries to access memory that does not belong to the program, and the Linux kernel shuts it down. Or, if you're on a Windows platform, well, behavior gets interesting, depending on what your permissions are. I guess that's true in a Linux platform, but it's harder to get escalated permissions while you're running a program that, has some bugs in it. It's possible, but the people who... There's such a wealth of libraries that do well at accessing just a minimal set of permissions for exactly the thing you need, that just things tend to work better on a Linux platform or a Unix platform. Anyway, so I was saying this morning that the program's not causing any segmentation faults. However, it was trying to access memory space that didn't belong to it. In response to that, I was using the GNU debugger tool, GDB. And it was not providing me very much useful information because the program was compiled in such a manner that it was detecting when the program was accessing memory that was on the stack in a way that didn't make sense. So because it was performing that detection and handling it inside the program, the GNU debugger didn't have access to the error codes, and I couldn't find a simple way, to get access to the proper error code. So what I had to do is change the makefile and add in this new no stack protector argument when we're in debugger mode, which takes all the canaries out of the stack so the program is no longer able to detect within its own memory space when it's doing things that don't make sense, but rather can access memory that's outside of the program instead and tend to cause segmentation faults more often. So that was my approach this morning. This afternoon, I did take a brief look at this code before getting on the stream and found some interesting things just in terms of how the move generator works. I didn't have time, or didn't have both the energy and the time to do the research until now, unfortunately. Otherwise, maybe I would have gotten this done a little bit sooner. But so here's the move generator. What was interesting is that the move generation was done in, not in this generate pawn moves, but in the thing that calls it generate. Let me look for pawn moves. So yeah. The move generation was previously done in this generate all method. Now I'm trying to move it into a context where it will only get called where necessary, so we're not generating the same set of drops over and over. I don't know if we were in the first place, but one thing I would like to do would be able to generate the drops prior to generating the piece moves, unless we're actually performing captures. And so that was, I hadn't had time before the stream, or maybe I should have checked this out before, I don't know. It's more fun to do things live. But, so what I'm looking into now is the way that I move the code around, or what they call refactoring, extracting, and so forth. Is that done in such a manner that does not call this when captures are occurring. I think it doesn't. I think that we're only calling generate drops in blocks of the code where captures would not occur. So like here we have generate pawn moves, and we have say ignore or do not generate captures. I think prior to doing that though, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I want to grab these lines of code. In fact, yeah, this is the first thing that's done. After we've determined the target based on whether or not the moves to be generated must be forcing moves like checks and so forth. So after we've gotten beyond that point in the code and figured out if we're doing evasions, if we're doing quiet checks, then we use the target set of destination squares as part of the drops function. So previously this target was being generated independently. Now I'm trying to fan it into just the generic way that we move the pieces, but say you can also move pieces from off the board as part of your crazy house move of placing a captured piece, or in this case a pawn. You'll see that we're using a template function. Let me go back to the definition. So here this is saying I want to be able to sorry, I went to the wrong thing. I want to go to generate drops. Okay, so here's the template function. This says it's going to generate drops based on whatever piece type and checks values are passed into the method. Piece type refers to the type of piece that we're attempting to drop. Checks refers to whether the move has to be a drop. In many cases, well, also, I should mention that the parameters or arguments of the method are the position in which we're performing the drop, the list of the other moves, plus this is going to be the container for the moves that we're generating, and the bitboard target of just all the squares that we are considering as destination squares. Normally that would be used by the move generation function just in terms of figuring out what pawns you're going to translate or move across the board as opposed to drop. But in this case, it works fine as a drop target as well, because pawns will still perform checks and so forth on that same target. Or target just could be all the vacated squares, in which case that's still fine. It's just really a coincidence that we're able to drop this generate drops function right into the middle of the move generation code, and target has sensible values. That's kind of amazing. I'd like to think it's a coincidence. Maybe it's not. Maybe the Stockfish developers really were thinking super far ahead and thinking of variants or other reasons they want to do this. Either way, I kind of lucked out, I guess. So those are the arguments of the method. This method or function returns a ext move, which is a some sort of external move container. It's returning a pointer to that container. The container just is a singly linked list of all the moves that got generated. Here's the body of the generate drops function. It says if the player has the piece, or if the player to move has in hand the piece type that we're interested in dropping, then go make all your moves. Like here we have the make drop function, which says for each square that we're considering, generate a drop on that square. Here's the pop least significant bit function. So this is going to take each bit by bit and take it off the bit board and say we're going to make another drop for this square. So B is initialized here. We see to the set of empty squares, which is the set of squares that do not have pieces on them, plus the target. I'm not sure if not plus the target, but bitwise anded with the target, meaning it needs to be the intersection of empty squares and the set of squares that we're considering dropping on. This might be a bit redundant, in fact, because I think in both contexts this target has to be empty to begin with. Let me double check. I should have checked this before going on stream, but whatever. So, let's see. If we're not doing captures, yeah. Then empty squares is equal to target or, how's this read? Empty squares is equal to, now if we're doing quiet moves or quiet checks, it needs to be the target in particular. Otherwise, it can just simply be empty squares. Okay, so that's the one context where we have empty squares defined. That empty squares bitboard does get bitwise anded with the target, right? Where do we reuse that? Empty squares. Oh, B1 and B2. Okay, cool. I see. So B1 is the set of pawns not on the 7th rank with respect to the player on move, and empty squares. So this is looking for, and this is looking for double pawn pushes. And of course, when we're dropping a piece, it doesn't really matter where we're dropping it. But that's where empty squares is taken into account. What I'm interested in, well, let's see, where is, does this thing have a target in it? Oh, okay. Well, that's pretty weird. Why is this only done for anti-chess? Empty squares has to be contained in the target if we're doing anti-chess, otherwise, I don't remember why. It's got me thinking. That's really got me curious. Why is that a rule that only makes sense in anti-chess? I do not know. Empty squares has to include the target. Where do we do things with the target? If we're doing evasions, yeah, I don't know. Something might be completely off with regard to that. But regardless, so that expression, target bitwise anded with empty squares, should generate the set of squares that are attacked by, or that are vacant, that are eligible to be dropped on. So that generate drops doesn't need to do that kind of calculation. Let me just double check one more time. Empty squares is equal to, if we're doing quiet moves or quiet checks, it has to be on the given squares. I'm not sure what quiets refers to specifically here, but there's a specific target in mind. Else, so target's only relevant in the event that we have certain squares we need to go to. Okay, so what we need is not target bitwise anded with empty squares, but just empty squares itself. Now, what needs to be taken into, well, the function itself will take that into account. We were there a minute ago, and I didn't explain this at all. So let's go back to where we have drops defined. Drops. Generate drops. So if we're generating a pawn drop, we cannot drop it onto the first or the eighth rank. So that's already taken care of for us. So this particular context doesn't need to be concerned with the fact that empty squares is going to contain squares that are on the first and eighth ranks, because the generate drops function already handles that. So that's generating pawn drops. Now we're looking at the other half of this, which has to do with, for other piece types, how do we handle that? So So here we have a concept of a target. I wonder if this does anything similar with regard to that target. So like here we're saying if we have to give check, if the move that we're generating must be a check, then it does some fancy logic to say, oh, by the way, if I don't have any pieces that I can move on the board to give a check that are of this type, then just skip to the next piece in the list. Huh. Whatever. That's kind of interesting, but I can't think of a way to optimize that. There might be potential for optimization, but who cares at this point? If there were a way to greatly optimize this based on like where our potential attacks, I guess that would be already done. This is probably as efficient as it gets, and if not, somebody else is going to discover that optimization anyway. Okay, so yeah, if we have to give check, then our set of destination squares is not only going to be where our pieces can move. So here's a bit board of all the pieces of a given type, so like all the rooks, all the bishops, all the knights of a given type. I assume also of a given color. Let's assume that. I'm pretty sure it's the case. So this is saying, where are all the destinations for all my pieces of a given piece type? And if I have to give check, this is the set of destination squares for that piece type. So that can be done independently of this other half that I introduced, which is saying, if we're playing Crazy House, we have to generate drops based on the piece type and based on whether it's needs to be a check or not. This is what got me hung up a little bit earlier. This defines a target, as in the squares that your pieces must go to. It's possible that you might be forced to give check in response to a check. You might be forced to, I don't know. But regardless, this is the set of squares to be considered by generate moves. Generate moves is called by generate all. So we have a type of move. So there's a thing called quiets, and there's a constant called quiet checks. I'm not sure what the difference between quiets and quiet checks is, but generate all calls, generate moves for each piece type. And I think sure captures take priority over just moving pieces. Oh wait, where is generate all called from? Because even generate all has a target in mind. Okay, so we have generate. So one thing that's kind of interesting, and I did mention the fact that these are template functions. What template functions are pieces of code that are macros that generate more code. That's like, they actually call it generated code, if I remember correctly. And that generated code, it essentially multiplies your code into multiple copies. Each copy of it can be optimized. And in fact, it only generates the sections of code that are needed. It's not so relevant in this context, although it just means that, imagine that we have this function, but it's defined multiple times. And so it's defined as generate captures, generate quiets, and generate non-evasions. So this is called multiple times. Each time it determines the target of squares to be attacked, captures has to, well, obviously you have to make the target the set of the opponent's pieces. Quiets refers to non-captures and under-promotions. And non-evasions refers to pseudo-legal captures and non-captures. All these refer to pseudo-legal moves. But this is referring to captures and queen promotions. This is referring to other promotions as well as non-captures. And this is referring to, there's other constants as well. There's generate evasions, there's generate quiet checks and so forth. There's a lot of constants in this code, and it's tricky to keep track of it all. But yeah, generate non-evasions generates all pseudo-legal captures and non-captures. So that has me confused. Oh, so I guess there's a thing, generate evasions, which refers to just get your king out of check or block the check. Or capture the checking piece. I'm not so sure about that. Although I think that's already handled by generate captures. There's a lot of nuances here. So the key here, so we see, like, here we have generating captures. What I need to do is have a way... Oh, I now see where this is going. Oh, that's unfortunate now, isn't it? Okay, so target is equal to... If it's captures, it's equal to the opponent's pieces. If it's quiets, it's equal to where they're empty squares. And if it's equal to non-evasions, the target is equal to not our pieces. And if it's none of the above, which it has to be one of the above, because we assert that that's the case. So this zero at the end just means that it's a constant just that has to be there just for the sake of having a default value. But yeah, so the target's going to be one of either not our pieces, I'm sorry, yeah, our opponent's pieces, or... empty squares, or squares that are not occupied by our pieces, because you obviously can't move to where your pieces are located. Unfortunately, this whole generate all business does not, it only passes in what's the set of target squares. It does not pass in whether or not that target is the set of empty squares, or whether it's the set of all squares minus our pieces squares. So generate all is called twice. Quiets and non-evasions are the two constants that are used to help generate that target. Oh, never mind. Type is passed in as a, I forget what they call this. I think a template parameter. We do have visibility to this type. That same type being the value captures, quiets, or non-evasions. We have the visibility to that from the generate all definition, which was up here at the top of the file, which we saw it calls generate moves. However, when it calls generate moves, it's looking for quiet checks as a type. There's a lot of types. So I need to figure out, what do I do here? Generate all. So this was not passed a target, so this has three types, captures, quiets, and non-evasions. I'm not sure where quiet checks comes from. I'm sorry, there's multiple generate functions. There's a generate function for quiet checks. It's called separate of the other generate function. How many other generates are there? There's generate evasions, so that's five types. There's generate legals, which generates all legal moves, which is just exhaustive. So there's six. There's generate legal, which just forcibly generates all the legal moves. There's generate evasions, generating all pseudo-legal evasions when the side moves in check. Generate quiet checks. all pseudo-legal non-captures and knight under promotions that give check. Because, yeah, queen promotions that give check and already handle all the squares that, say, a rook check or a bishop promotion check could happen. So there's already a way to generate promotion moves that give check in the same direction that a rook or a bishop would give check. So really the only thing Stockfish cares about is a knight promotion also capable of giving check, because that can drastically change the way that a game proceeds. If a player is put in check and then loses a piece, that could be pretty vital. Generate evasions, generates all pseudo-legal check evasions when the side to move is in check. So this also... Oh, okay, now I know how to do this. I put the wrong sign there. So we've got captures, which are all the captures, quiets, which are all the non-captures, plus the set of under promotions, non-evasions, which covers captures plus non-captures. How is that? Oh, that's pseudo-legal. That's different than generate legal. I'm confused. How is non-evasions? Maybe at one point that was doing something different. That seems like a really strange name. We have generate quiet checks, which generates all the pseudo-legal non-captures and knight under promotions that could check. Which we saw in the generate move function. The one that we call here. Well, I'm sorry, the one that generate all calls, generate moves. Is concerned with giving check if and only if the type of move to be generated is quiet checks. Otherwise, it doesn't care whether or not the move is check. That's interesting. I'm not sure why it was done that way. Oh, I forgot to look at the other parameters to these methods. So this one takes does not accept a bitboard of squares called a target, so it has to formulate the target on its own. So for generating quiet checks, we just have to look for the target's a square that are not occupied by any piece. So it's the checks which are not captures. So obviously a different way to do that would be I need to generate this set of quiet moves. What's the difference between quiets and quiet checks? Oh, yeah, obviously. Quiet checks is a subset of quiet moves. What you could do... I'm trying to think of some logical way you could break this apart. Like, you could generate non-evasions, which would be a set of pseudo-legal captures and non-captures. And then you could even then that's inefficient. But yeah, they have a specialized form of this, which just generates pseudo-legal non-captures and pseudo-legal knight under promotions that could check. I think that give check here, this qualifier, also refers to the non-captures, of course. So for generating quiet moves, we don't really care if we're giving check or not. That's the point. Okay, I'm kind of dense, but I think I finally figured that out. Generate evasions generates all the ways to block a check or to move the king out of check, or I assume to capture the checking piece. Which, that's pretty simple unless you're playing atomic chess, which is why there's all that atomic code around here. But yeah, either way it defines the target of... Well, first, I think part of what this does is generate all the squares that the king can run to. There's so much atomic code all over here that it's tricky to read the rest. Where did the king square go to? Okay, so... Yeah, this defines all the squares that a piece can go to interpose to block the check. But separately, it's got to have something here to generate... Oh, here's the thing to generate king moves. Obviously, this is somewhat different for atomic as well, because in atomic chess, if you put the kings adjacent to each other, that makes it legal, no matter what your move is. So, if the kings are already adjacent, you're not in check, you don't have to worry about that. You just can't move the king out of the way, away from the opposing king, into check. Anyway, generating legal moves is kind of a pain. We see that... Oh. Well, I should probably add something here. Something... Is this even necessary to add something here? The win conditions in all these different variants differ from normal chess. However, in three-check chess, the win condition's the same, so we don't actually need a specialized check for has the game already ended. And in case that case, don't generate any moves. We don't need anything like that because checkmate ends the game here as well. Okay, so what's the deal with this? Else if Crazyhouse move type is drop and move is... Oh, okay, so this is just generating the set of legal moves, so we have to perform a legal move check on every drop as well. Not sure why that wouldn't be done by default. Oh, right, so yeah, if we're playing, this is concerning. I don't like this. If the type of the move is a drop, well, the origin square of the move, it could not possibly be. It could not possibly be the king square. That's okay. Good gravy, this is confusing. So if we're performing a validation, which... says if any of our... Wait. Pinned is equal to do we have any pinned pieces? And if we have pinned pieces, then we need to perform validation. But we can't perform... I mean... Yeah, we can have pinned pieces, but evasions are going to include... Oh man, what a mess. Okay, what this is going to boil down to is I'm just going to rewrite this section of code. It's a lot easier to rewrite things and then compare what you've ended up with than it is to try to repair code. So we're going to say if blah 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 else do the following. So our blah 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 here is going to be if our type of move is a drop, if our type of move is a drop, we need to perform a different kind of validation. Else we're going to perform validation as we would normally. In this case, because we're checking if the type of the move is... I don't know if that's efficient or not. We're going to do it this way. It might be inefficient. And then we're going to grab the rest of this, which I think does make sense. Say if our move is illegal, then discard it. Else, just perform our validation routine as we would normally. Let's see. That way we don't need to check, like, what's the origin square of the move, because that could have been from not on the board. And we don't have to be concerned of, is our type of move an en passant move? Would be convenient if I had some way of independently validating drops versus other types of moves, but I don't have that. Could always write that later. Don't have it right now. That's okay. Yeah, if we're playing Crazy House and we have a dropped kind of move, then we do need to perform validation, even if validation is disabled. Oh, this is saying if we have pinned pieces, or if we're moving the king, or our move is an en passant move, which can remove two pieces from the board at once, or rather can remove two pieces from a rank at the same time, and the king could potentially be on that rank. Also, en passant just has a way of, well, you know, the pawn would be pinned. Yeah. Yeah, that would be pinned, so that would be redundant in that case, but en passant can vacate two squares on a given rank at the same time, and the king could theoretically be on the rank, as could a checking piece. So you could have a indirect sort of pin. If any of those happen, then we do need to perform validation and potentially remove the move from the list. Yeah, it's unfortunate that the drops and the other moves are going to go into the same move list and need to be filtered out separately. Yeah, maybe this check for are we playing Crazy House is just over the top. So, if we're playing Crazy House and we have a drop kind of move, then we need to validate if it's legal. Do we have a way of seeing, is the side to move in check? If we have that handy, we should use it. If we don't have it handy, that's too bad. Hang on. So, evasions, let's see. Yeah, we only need to perform that validation if we're evading check. If we're not evading check, in fact, yeah, we have that. We have position.checkers. Now, that might not be cached. Let me take a look. In position.age, we have checkers. Checkers is cached. So, so this is a cached thing. It does not recompute the list of checking pieces every time. Therefore, let's see. Validate is equal to pinned. I mean, goodness, I could say if we're playing Crazy House, just always validate the move. No, that's over the top. It would save us some operations down here, but in the long run, it's not worth it. Because it would require calling the legal move validation routine more frequently than necessary. But yeah, if we're dropping a piece, we're not going to put ourselves into check. The only thing we're at risk of is that we might remain in check after the drop. So if we are in check and our move does not do anything to block the check. Oh wait, this is entirely redundant, unnecessary, isn't it? And I say that because generate evasions defines a, well, let's take a look at generate evasions. It should define the set of squares that are in the target. Where is this defined? So a set of evasions would be their pieces and the target, but here we're kind of lost in the weeds and generate pawn moves. It's funny how this colon is put there without a space. It does make it a little bit trickier to read, to be honest. It reads a little bit like a label. So if we're generating evasions, the enemies are their pieces, but also in the set of target squares, the set of target squares being whatever is passed into the function. Basically saying that enemies is only the set, I guess, of checking pieces. I don't know. But yeah, what I was attempting to prove was that if the type is evasions, then performing a legal move check is kind of unnecessary. And we're going to try to just look at not necessarily pawn moves. So here we have non-evasions. Generates all pseudo-legal captures and non-captures. I'm not sure if that's actually accurate. I mean, that does not sound like the complement of evasions. Let's see. Where is evasions? This generates all pseudo-legal check evasions when the side to move is in check. Returns a pointer to the end of the move list. So when we're generating evasions, this defines the target as the set of squares that are between the king and whatever is giving check, but also including whatever is giving check. So you remember how I said here, we're only going to need to perform any kind of validation if we're already in check, because we're not moving a piece on the board. Well, turns out even that is a bit of an overstatement, because we've already considered if we're in check, we need to generate evasions. This is really the only case where we're concerned about performing a validation, and that validation's unnecessary because the set of target squares is already defined and should be enforced at the time we're generating the move. So the already generated drop only can occur on a square that actually blocks the check. Now you'll note that generate evasions actually has something kind of smart in it. I think if I remember right, yeah. If they have multiple pieces giving check, then only a king move can be generated. Otherwise, we generate all moves that go to that set of target squares that are between the king and the checking piece, including the checking piece. But what this all boils down to is that if the type of move is a drop, what this all boils down to is that if the type of move is a drop, we do not need to perform any validation because we're not going to expose our king to check. It's going fine. I'm making some progress here with Crazyhouse chess coding. That's unintentional alliteration right there. So here we have validate, or the square you're moving, the piece you're moving is the king, or it's en passant and all that. Then you need to call this other function called position.legal. or this function called legal on the object called POS, which is of type position or class position. But yeah, if we're dropping a piece, we don't really need to be concerned at all with this kind of... Oh, hang on. Well, wait. Let me think. Yeah, there is still merit in having a legal move checker. It's just not in the generator that we need. It's in the remainder of the, like, the move picker that'll inject moves that could potentially be illegal. Things like what they call the killer moves in a position. Things that, regardless of what the opponent plays, you generally have a few canned responses that you play over and over. Those would still need to be validated using the legal move function, so I can't just take this line of code and shift it into position.legal. I have to put it here. But yeah, I think this additional if statement's not going to be very costly at all. Is there anything else I can do to make it less costly? Not necessarily for Crazy House, but just for normal chess. I think for normal chess, what would be most efficient would be if I put something down here. Not sure about the ordering of these statements. Type of... See, this would not occur very often in a normal chess game. Let's optimize that for the 90% use case, which is most people are using this to play normal chess, but we still need to perform this kind of check, or at least it benefits us to do it this way, because piece drops, by and large, are legal and don't need all kinds of fancy validation. So that should boost performance quite a bit. But what I originally came here to do was make the code work. There's still some bugs to be worked out. And I'm learning more as I refactor this and code it a little bit more, but... yeah, this additional check there is fine because most of the time in a normal chess game, you're going to have this is already satisfied, or this is already false, and therefore this doesn't need to be checked most of the time. And this is just one additional check here. Like, if I were to reorder this and put the type of move comparison first, then we'd be missing out on the... Which is, really, we're only going to need to do any of this if we're, like, moving the king, or if we have a pinned piece. So that's fine. That's all well and good. Anything else? So I should go back to the top. And we're going to look for other instances of Crazy House here. So here's the new function, as we already pointed out. This generates drop moves that are in the set of squares defined by the target, bitboard target here. As we saw already, that target consists, or should consist, only of the squares, if we're in check, only the squares that are between us, our king, and whatever's checking us. I think this addition here has to be done. By addition, I mean subtraction. that we can't drop onto occupied squares. So it has to be done here because whatever's calling this generate drops I mean, here we are able to call it, and we know what squares are empty. Here, we don't know whether or not target is unoccupied, because this is the same move that's going to generate captures as well as inner positions. I suppose... Actually, I could do something fancy here. So, wait. Bool checks. Generate moves. Checks, I think, means if the move has to be a check. If I remember right. At least I'm pretty sure, yeah. You know, checks refers to do we have to give check. It'd be uncommon for that to be true at the same case as us needing to get out of check, but I suppose that could happen. But is there any way I can know whether or not the target contains occupied squares? I don't think so. We're not passing the move type as a parameter to this function. So this might not be a good place to do generating of drops. Might have to go outside of this. So generate moves. Where do we call this? 1, 2, 3, 4. Only those four places. I guess what we're gonna do. So I'm pretty sure that those are the only places we call that from. So I'm gonna need to actually grab this line of code and do something not so fancy, but it's functional. There's no point in doing a for loop here. So we're gonna generate knight drops. We're gonna generate bishop drops. We're gonna generate rook drops. We're gonna generate queen drops. And just for completeness sake, let's format it the same way that this down here is formatted. Now, we don't want to call this every time this function's called. We don't need to generate check. We don't need to generate drops all the time. Generate all. Under what circumstances do we call generate all? This is called, just in the generic generate function, given types of captures, that's the thing I was looking for, is we don't want to call this when we're performing captures. So, and where's the type argument? Oh, it's called type. There we go. So we don't generate this, we don't generate drop moves any more than we need to. So generates captures, quiet moves, not evasions. Now, if I remember right, smart thing that does the generate evasions. Hang on, let me search for this evasions. Does this already handle? Okay, yeah. It's the smartness that says we don't need to do generate blocking moves. Handles our case for drops as well, because generate all does not get called, and so therefore generate drops does not get called. For each of these, yeah. That's what it's called. All these four calls to generate drops get skipped in the event that our king is in double check. What other kinds of moves or what other kinds of generations do I need to be concerned with? So captures, obviously we're going to skip that. Quiets, as well as non-evasions. I don't know if we can bypass drops in either of those cases. Yeah, I think we need to generate all the drops in both quiets and in non-evasions, which I think is okay. Because the actual move function that moves the pieces on the board is only called in cases, or yeah, in cases where we don't have a hash table hit. So I think we're covered there. Does this generate thing do anything smart before it calls? Generate all? I mean, it defines the target of squares that we're going to, which we're not going to modify because we still do need to be able to move pieces. We just are, in addition, we're generating drops. But quiets versus non-evasions, I don't know. Pseudo legal captures and non captures. Actually, now that I think about it, this is going to get messy. Do I want to go here? No, I don't want to go there. I was going to say, you know, I could generate drops only when we're capturing, and that way they get generated during the capture phase. However, that would not handle the fact that we need to get out of check. So yeah, ideally you would want, you'd want to prioritize these as high as captures. You want to generate these during the same move generation phase that generates the captures. But just given the way the code is plumbed at the moment, it's not easy to do that. So we're going to have to piggyback on this and just delay the stuff until the time is right. So let's see, there's these specialized generate functions like quiet checks. Obviously, we want to call drops during that phase. That's only going to call drop pieces on the squares that would generate a check. And there's evasions. Obviously, we want to be able to block a check. And there's legal, which, I mean, it's self-explanatory. I'm just trying to figure out if quiets and non-evasions, I don't know. Does one of these have some kind of priority over the other or something? Like, why do they have both quiets and non-evasions? I guess non-evasions would mean we're looking for moves. Yeah, what's the deal with non-evasions anyway? I get quiets. Quiets would be we're not doing some kind of queen promotion. We're not doing some kind of... Oh, hang on. Here we got make promotions. I completely forgot about this. So, yeah, saying only generate promotions. Let's skip all the anti-chess code. So, only generate promotions if our move type is one of those three. Which, I mean, isn't that always the case if we're going through this set of code? Like, is there a case where we call make promotions and have a generation type that wasn't one of captures, evasions, or non-evasions? I guess it could be quiets. Yeah, quiets would say we want to generate rook, bishop, and knight. Whereas evasions and non-evasions, as well as captures, want to generate... better promotions. See, what I'm thinking is maybe we only want to drop during the non-evasions generation, and we might not want to do drops during quiets. Or we might want to do drops either during evasions or non-evasions, but not during quiet moves. I think Quiet's has a very specific purpose of saying we're only going to make these. There's a thing called Quiet Checks, though. This would be a check that's not a capture. I just wonder, why do they bother? How many sections of the code do they make some kind of distinction between non-evasions versus quiets? So there's the promotion generation. There's captures, which is going to include some... Maybe quiets is the best phase to generate the stuff after all. I mean, so not evasions has to concern itself with all kinds of captures and validation that occurs because of those captures. Well, I don't know. It's to concern itself very much with what's the set of target squares that we're going to. I totally get that evasions has to be its own generation thing, and non-evasions is the complement of evasions. And captures is we're only looking for captures. So I see all three of these could potentially include captures. Quiets looks for non-captures and under-promotions. How do we go about making quiet moves? I mean, here's our under-promotions, which we do have to make those under-promotions as well when we're trying to get out of check during evasions. And for completeness sake, non-evasions also includes them. But really the phase... maybe this is my expression. In fact, yeah, that's definitely the expression we want to be using. Because what's our other types? We have captures, which we don't care about. Legal, we don't care about. And there's... there was one more in here. What was it? Let me scroll back up. Sorry to for all the dizziness. I just can't remember all these things at once, and I don't have any way to write this down that's convenient at the moment. There's evasions, captures, quiets, non-evasions, quiet checks. That was the last one. But quiet checks, I think, includes quiets, does it not? Oh, generate all quiet checks. So it has a very... yeah, it does have a very specific target in mind. Oh, hang on. Or... Yeah, when we're performing evasions, we need to be able to drop. When we're not performing evasions, we still need to be able to drop. Oh, maybe I did get this right the first time. There's quiets, evasions, non-evasions, captures, legal. Is there really just five? I'm struggling to remember. Captures, quiets, there's quiet checks, non-evasions. Evasions and legal. Those are the six. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And really, yeah. Anything other than captures, we do need to do this. We can't skip this. However, and this is the thing to watch out for, is that quiet checks, where's that looked for down here? Oh, come on. Where is it? Oh, okay. So we're already passing into the function whether or not it must give check. So for evasions and non-evasions, we don't care for giving check. For captures, we certainly don't care. Not that we're going to call this, not that we're going to call generate drops in that event anyway. And for quiets, we have no restriction that it must be check. So that's the way it's I get it. So only if checks is specified, then we need to bitwise and the target with a set of squares at which our pieces could be dropped to perform a check. Otherwise, we don't care. So I now have a better appreciation. I'm not explaining this very well, but I've been vocalizing my thoughts as I go on. So, yeah, we are five move types. Really, four in this context. Quiet checks, evasions, and non-evasions. We've already established that for quiet checks, we need to move to a square that, or we drop on a square at which we're giving check. Otherwise, we don't care. If we're doing evasions... Wait. Yeah, what is the value of target in all these cases? So, let's go to the quiet check generator, which passes in a target. The target is just a set of empty squares, which matches, so for evasions, the target is the set of squares between your king and the checking piece, plus the checking piece. So, let's see. Where was the generate function? So we know that for quiet checks, the target that we passed in is the set of empty squares. For quiets, it's a set of empty squares. For non-evasions, it's a set of squares that are not occupied by our pieces. And for evasions, it's a set of squares that block the check. So that's four sets of possible things. All four of those targets, three out of the four of those targets do not include squares that contain pieces. The one of those that does include squares that contain pieces is evasions. And only in that very specific context of generating moves to evade a check do we need to perform this particular operation. In fact, there's no reason to perform it here when we can perform it in the calling context instead. But let me back up. We're going to grab this bitboard B. Bitboard B is equal to target. How do I go about this? Type is equal to evasions. If so, we need to subtract the checking piece. So, by doing that in advance, then each of the four times that we call this, we do not need to perform that same step. All right, so where is generate moves and what does it do with target? Generate moves, I'm just curious stylistically at this point. What does this look like? So here, where's bitboard B defined? Okay. So it's, in this case, we do need to define all these separate bitboards and stuff. hang on. There we go. And now when we call generate drops, I could just call this B right there. That removes another line of code. Let's see. Obviously, some of this gets inlined anyway, but I'm just trying to make this as simple as possible for readability's sake and for proof of correctness sake. in the event that we have to debug this later. If piece type is equal to pawn, then we need to exclude ranks 1 and 8. See, I can move this now. Generate drops can now have this stuff here. Clipboard B is equal to empty squares minus squares on ranks 1 and 8. And that way, inside the body of generate drops, we don't need to check is this a pawn. Again, the compiler's pretty smart. It can optimize a ton of things. It probably could eventually figure out how to optimize that, but, you know, for readability's sake, I'm trying to keep this as simple as possible. Okay, if we have a pawn in hand, or if we have whatever piece in hand, then we're able to drop it, and so... here, if checks, the target needs to be ended with whatever squares would give check for that piece type. I'm going to trust the compiler's just going to inline that just fine. I don't need to worry about it. And yeah, the rest of this is your pop the square off of the bit board. And generate a piece of the side to move. Probably should have done that in advance of the loop. do I need to worry about that? Is the compiler going to optimize that? Gosh, I hope so. It would be a really sad compiler if it couldn't optimize the fact that side to move is not changing for every iteration of that loop. So I think that's fine. Okay, it does bother me that make piece is only called in this one context. Where is make move? Specifically, not just where is this called from, but where is this defined? Make move is defined inside, types.h. Return move from left shift 6 plus 2. Okay. Holy moly, that's scary. Make drop does type drop plus piece left shifted 18 plus 2. So this takes a square. This takes a piece. I'm confused. Why does this need a piece instead of a piece type? Make piece is kind of expensive. Well, let's see. Where is move defined? Enum move. Okay. Um,
The move needs 16 bits to be stored, the destination square, the origin square, the promotion piece, and special move flag. Yeah, so I'm seriously questioning, why does this need to call make piece? I guess I'll have to ask the guy who developed that and see, like, do we really need to figure this out? Do we really need that type of piece? Also, does this file ever, anywhere, keep track of the side to move? Let's see, generate drops is called from, I mean, this, we've already determined, we've passed as a template parameter, color us. Here, it does not have a template parameter. Does it anywhere at any point during move generation care about which color is on move? I hope so. That seems crazy that this would be able to. Oh, okay, here it is. Color us is argument 3. Parameter 3, whatever you want to call it. Generate moves. It's called from here. Yeah. So I can actually do this as template code. Generate drops can accept as a parameter color us. That way we don't need to interrogate the position over and over to figure which side is on move. Just say, if the player us has a piece in hand, and of course any of these changes I'm making the other developer can revert if they, by all means, they have better testing tools prepared than I do at the moment. So the fact that I'm making a change doesn't make it permanent in any sense. They're well more than able to experiment with it and find the best way to write all this. So I think we're good to go. Oh, hang on. So for this to work, we do need to pass in the information we have access to. Otherwise, that's not going to work so well. Oops. There we go. This might actually generate two sets of this function, one for white, one for black, one for knights, one for bishops, one for rooks, one for queens, etc. But given that all that code is all called here inline anyway, well, I don't know how it does the generated code, I don't know how it does the full link time optimization, but gosh, I hope it's smart enough to inline some of this. If not, we can fix that later. But now this code is in a state where I understand it. Now time for the acid test we've all been waiting for. Compile. Okay, it's compiled. Just had to compile the one file, because I only changed one file, no matter how much code I read there. Okay, I broke it. It is obviously broken. How do I simplify the test? Well, let's start by reducing, I don't know, position, start position. Go two moves deep. Okay, two moves deep works. go 5 moves deep. 5 moves deep fails. In fact, we probably failed at hitting a depth of 4 there as well. Captured is equal to no piece, or color of captured is equal to type of move is not castling. Okay. So now we break out the tools. Let me put this in my copy paste clipboard buffer. Break out the GNU debugger, GDB. So we're going to run the program and we're going to paste in that input. And here we get a stack trace of where the code failed. Captured is equal to no piece or blah, 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 blah. Which failed from do move. I assume this is during the capture. Wait, where am I? So we've turned off optimization. This is doing quiescent search. Position, .cpp 11.14. Obviously we, okay, depth QS, depth of quiescent search, no checks. So this is still generating quiet moves. When, I don't know about that. I do not know. I'd have to look at the search code. Search 1602. It's the last part of the search code we were at, which is quiescent search, which called doMove. DoMove, but prior to this, we must have generated some moves. And that's what bugs me, is like, was the move generation incorrect? Given that I wrote the code, probably. Depth of 0, depth of quiescent search without checks. Not sure how to read some of this. The node type of 0, true or false. Let's look at search CPP line 1602. Yeah, so this performs the move. Okay, what part of this failed, I wonder? Captured is equal to no piece, or colored of the captured piece is... Oh, if we did a castling move, it's our color, otherwise it's the opposing color. Captured. And position, CPP line 1114. Let's see if we can narrow this down a little bit, okay? Before I go too far in depth, let's go back to depth 3. This should still duplicate the bug. Oops. So, depth 3 does not duplicate the bug. Why is that not duplicated? Okay. But regardless, what we're going to do to narrow this down a bit is say, start position with moves of E2, E3, A7, A6, and do a two-move search from there. That did not duplicate the bug. Do a three-move search from there. Okay, there we go. Now we're talking. So I'm not sure where exactly that failed, but I'm curious if a three-move search starting with just one E3 also fails. No. Okay. A7, A6, F1, A6. Let's do a two-move search from there. That fails. Now let's, I don't know if it really matters what black does, but let's do a one-move search. Okay. So, the second that white has a pawn to drop on the board, everything goes wrong. And this is with a one depth search. I don't know if a zero depth search makes any sense, but apparently it also duplicates the issue. So we're going exactly one half move forward. That fails. So what if I say instead of go depth, if I say perfed? That worked. Okay. So I'll assume that this is occurring at the same place in the code, but I don't know for sure. So we have to figure that out. Let's put this in our clipboard again and call GNU debugger, run, and execute, hit stack trace, quit, and our stack trace, I assume, puts us back through that quiescent search code. Surely it must. So thread, which calls search, which calls search, which calls do move. But the move that we generated obviously was nonsense. But I don't know what that move was. Is there any way I can simplify this a little bit? I don't think so. Okay, let's do a different test here. Let's not do this position. Let's do E3, H5, D1, H5, H8, H5, in which case white doesn't have any captures on hand. Let's grab this again. And we're going to run stockfish, run, paste, go. So, yeah. This puts us through that same section of code. We get the same stack dump. After getting the stack dump, obviously this happens in do move because we generated an illegal move somehow. There's no way that this assertion's wrong, right? This assertion's not something I just recently added. Yeah, now this has been here a long time. I don't know which part of this failed. Assert captured is equal to no piece, or color of captured is not our color. White doesn't even have a capture after rook takes queen. Obviously we set up the position right and we got the search started. So this is the part where I start putting debugging information into the code. Where was I last doing that? Here. So we want to do something similar here. Add if1 just to set it apart. And now, instead of doing an assertion, we're going to say if neither of these is satisfied, so something like that. Then do the printf statement. Should print out the board position. And that'll give us a better idea of what's the circumstance under which it code failed. At this point, the GNU debugger isn't really helping very much. Let's see. So the position under which this failed was... that doesn't look right at all. That can't be it. Position 1114. Oh, I forgot to compile the code. No wonder that failed. and failed the same way it failed last time, which did not provide exactly the message I was looking for. Okay. So here's the position. What does this look like? Let's take a look. So Leechess's board editor doesn't necessarily accept a full FEN string in the same format that the program's printing it out. Okay, so this is what the position looks like at the point that this failed. So that doesn't tell me the value of captured, but it does tell me that this assertion failed in that position, where white has a pawn, black has a queen in hand. Assert captured is equal to no piece, or the color of the captured is not equal to us. Well, that clearly has failed. So before we go too far, let's try to narrow this down one thing at a time, right? Empty squares minus the first or eighth ranks. And we're pretty sure that empty squares are indeed empty, right? So empty squares is equal to, if the type is quiet or quiet checks, it's equal to the target, else it's equal to squares that are empty. And the target would be, well, for quiet checks, it's pretty obvious, it's a set of squares at which we're delivering a check. For quiets, it's just the set of squares that are not occupied by an opponent's piece. Oh, that's kind of problematic now, isn't it? So we're not occupied by an opponent's piece. I guess for a non-captured pawn move, that suffices because, wait. How does this work? Just for normal chess. Say if I've got doubled pawns, and I want to move my pawns upward. How do I ensure that my pawns aren't, like, killing each other? I'm confused. How is it that if we're generating just a quiet move and we have doubled pawns, that we're not having our pawns collide with each other as a result of using this as empty squares? So that's really confusing to me. But also, I see that just my general strategy is kind of flawed, and that it. Oh wait, this target's only really considered here anyway. Oh, good gravy. They did not make this easy. I now see why the other developer didn't try doing it this way. So let's cut the problem space in half, just for the sake of starting somewhere. If false and this, do the following. Obviously, that will never get executed. Surprisingly, there's no compiler warning. But whatever. So that seems to have fixed the immediate problem, is just getting rid of the pawn drop. Now let's make our test a little bit more robust. Fine. Oh. There we go. I meant to do editing of this file. Let's see. Do we get five moves deep without an error? Yes. Can we handle the original position? So let's reorder these back so we have the original test in place. Can we go to 20 moves deep in the thing that was originally causing the defect before we started? I'm suspecting no is the answer, but it'd be a relief if I've exchanged my original problem for a new problem, and that original problem is no longer reproducible. That would be a relief, honestly. Apparently the way I coded it, though, is anything but efficient. Hmm. That's not good. This used to get much higher depth numbers in this kind of time. I wonder what I could do to make this more efficient. Yeah, this is unacceptable performance. So not only have I broken a code and put in some temporary patch code, but what we've put in place now is not performing very well either. Which is very unfortunate. But yeah, I think we figured out that empty squares, which gets bitwise ended with where are my pawns and so forth. Let's see. If our type is quiets or quiet checks. I totally get quiet checks. We totally need to move our pawns forward, not perform captures. Oh. Oh, where's target defined? Target's passed into the function. But surely target consists of the squares that are unoccupied. Yeah, if we're doing evasions, I'm sorry, not evasions, if we're doing just quiet moves, let's cover not there, not there, not there, there's generate all, here we go, generate quiets is equal to squares that are not occupied by our pieces. So, yeah, in the case where we're doing, quiet moves or quiet checks, we do want to use empty squares, which is the same as target. Otherwise, we want to use squares that are not occupied by our piece, any piece. That actually seems sufficient. I don't see any need to do any kind of special thing here. Maybe my subtraction operator is broken. That'd be really sad, but it's possible. Wait, I have three arguments to this generate drops function. Us knight checks. Let's see, color, piece type, and whether or not we need to give check. I think all that's still fine. Yeah, I'm not sure why this is suddenly not performant. Clearly, we need to drop on empty squares. Preferably closer to our opponent, but, you know, we can move them. Or closer to our king, but that's fine. And yeah, generate drops. Maybe I did end up causing quite a bit of template code. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know how much of this is a matter of the compiler not optimizing versus me just writing bad code. It's probably a little column A, a little column B, to be honest. But yeah, we have our position, we have a move list. I don't see anything wrong with that. And yet somehow it managed to generate a capture of our own piece, I presume. I mean, what else could it have done that suggests that? So, us has to be the player on move, right? I mean, surely. Who would design some section of code and make us not the player on move? The player not on move, rather. That would be just villainously, heinously evil. And there's no way that that's the case. So if we have the piece type in hand, for each square in the target, make a drop. That's fine. That all looks okay. So what we're gonna do, if zero, and if, there we go. So we're gonna bypass all of that. And see if we still get our illegal moves. And if we do still get our illegal moves, we kind of know what's up, right? Right, so now we're playing a kind of crazy house where the only captures that are, well, that's not even the thing I intended to test, but let me go back to my other test, which had to do with the start position. And not necessarily a depth of 20, but just let's go 5 moves out. If we're just dropping pawns, so far, so good. What if we go a little bit deeper? Okay. So here we are, f1, d3, f7, f5, pawn, g4, f5, g4, d3, g6, pawn, h3, g6, h5, pawn takes g2. Do move. This type of capture not equal to king. Oh. So is this saying that, let me try to visualize this. Or rather, because I'm kind of bad at visualizing, because I don't know exactly where we're at. Yank these three lines of code. Go to line 1119. And this is the assertion that failed. Above this, I'm going to add in a check. In fact, right here. So we're going to say, if. We already know we're not playing anti-chess, we're playing Crazy House. If type of piece that's captured is equal to the king, we've kind of got an issue. And we need to print out what's the position and how did we end up capturing the king. So let's compile that and try to see what's our position at the time the failure occurs. So this is the FEN for our position, Forsyth Edwards notation. Let's load said position. Indeed, white is in check. White needs to block the check. So H3, G2. That's the last line it calculated prior to this. I'm still not seeing, like, okay, it's black's move somehow here. I was about to say I don't see how this is anything but legal. But yeah, I'm not sure what the previous move was. Oh, here's a thought. Instead of conditionally dumping the position, because here we have so many positions. Well, it's not going to give me very good context, is it? This is going to be sad. If one. Oh, hang on. I know what I can do. So I'm going to say, yeah, obviously I've hideously broken something here. So I'm going to put something both at the front of the move generator and at the end of the move generator. Duh. So here we are. Before we make a move, let's just put this in line one there. And then after we make a move, side to move, side to move, set check info, set positions okay. There we go. This is going to be way more information than we needed, but it'll work. Because we're not doing a very deep search here. That, then after the move, do that, and this way we'll get a set of before and after sets of things. Now it's saying that this is the position in which a failure occurs, and I could see, like, how did we get here? Well, that we had here just a second ago was this other position. Hang on. And there's ways I can filter this, obviously, but let's load this and see what this looks like. Okay. White to move. Right? This is white to move? Yeah. White to move. And then after white's made his move, this is the position. There we go. Just double click that. That's pretty nice. Okay, so white puts a pawn on e5. Is the move. Yeah. That's the deal. Is that white needs to generate an evasive move, and instead he just puts a pawn on e5. And so he gets his king taken. So, how did I break this? If we have the piece in hand, if we have to give check, which we don't, else here's our move list. Move list takes our bit board and pops the bits off of it. Empty squares. Wait. Does this not have a concept for evasions in here? Oh. So if we're generating quiet moves, then we need to use the target. I'm going to need to make a third bit board. That's what this comes down to. Yikes. Well, it couldn't be avoided now, could it? So, if def. Crazy house. End it. Bit board B3 is equal to empty squares. And then down. Whoops. Well, we only need to define that if we're actually playing Crazy House. Okay, so let me actually inline this down here. It's going to be a mess. Bit board B is equal to type is equal to evasions. Target or empty squares. And here we want to say B minus rank That's fine. B minus equals this set of squares. This is what we were missing earlier. I think I defined this operator. I hope I did. Palm drop isn't categorized correctly. Okay. Can I inline this any... I'm trying to think, can I make this any prettier to read? But at this point, beauty isn't as much of a concern as just making sure it works. Don't need these parentheses. Because that's the entire statement. It makes sense to make this separate. I thought that there were... Rep rank 8, start at H. Rep rank BV, start at H. I thought that there was something, some convenience method that got the squares between ranks 2 and 7. Apparently not. Types.h rank. Actually, where is rank BB? It's in bitboard.h. Rank BB. Seventh? Is seventh in here? Is eighth in here? Is the number seven anywhere in this file? I mean, this is kind of silly. Yeah, so they have rank 1 BB through rank 8 BB. So I don't need to do a lookup. I can just say let's see, here we are. Actually, here it is too. T rank 8 BB. Oh, but yeah, we need to subtract both these rank 1 and rank 8. Because we can't drop on our own first rank either. We're not moving a pawn, we're dropping it, and so we need to subtract both of these. But we could say this or that. But now the whole thing about beauty kind of applies, and I think I could actually fit that up here. There we go. I mean, yeah, it exceeds column 80, but I don't care. Some people are pretty strict about that sort of thing. I'm not as strict. A minus equal B, yes. Yeah, I added some syntactic sugar because I was tired of writing code and getting that sort of thing incorrect. So I've made it such that with a single operator, I can define that kind of relationship. So I don't F things up like I've done in the past. Syntactic sugar keeps me sane. It's more for my own benefit than for anybody else's. I mean, I could probably even do some commutative operation, like minus rank 1 BB and then minus rank 8 BB, but this is fine, I think. So let's recompile and see, do we see the same error message? Granted, you just got here, we're playing a subset of Crazy House where only pawns can be dropped. And seeing, does that work? No, it fails. That fails. Okay, it's white to move in this position. Do move. Captured is equal to no piece. Color of captured, type of castle, and then us. Well, here's the position in which the latest error message happens. Happens in this position. So white's taken, black is taken back. White has a pawn. Surely White does not want to capture his own pieces. And yet that's either White's taken one of his own pieces or he's tried to take the rook. Well, no. This says that he's captured one of his own pieces, and it's certainly not a castling move. I've still got something wrong here. Bitboard B is equal to, are we doing evasive moves? We need to consider the target. See, logically, what is this doing? Logically, if we're not doing captures, which we're totally not, then empty squares is defined as the target or a set of vacant squares. So if we're doing quiet moves, the target we didn't know, we looked at like 10 minutes ago. Target is defined as a set of squares that do not contain one of our pieces. Right? That's what I saw earlier, I'm pretty sure. All pseudo-legal, non-captures, and under promotions. Oh, so okay. Yeah, if we're generating quiet moves, or quiet checks, well, if quiet checks is a different matter, but quiet moves, the target is equal to vacant squares. Otherwise, empty squares is something that needs to be determined, and is determined on the fly. So, empty squares is always empty, is the point. Empty squares could be a subset of empty squares if we're only looking for quiet checks, but usually it'll be more than just that. So how am I using this down here? If we're doing evasions, then we need to consider the target, else we need to consider empty squares. So if we're doing evasions, but we're not doing evasions, I mean, goodness. In that start position, White is not in check. Not even close to being in check. After rook takes queen. So, okay, what else do I need to consider? Let's just go through this. We're not doing anti-chess, so here normally we would look at where are our pawns stationed and are there empty squares in front of them and yada yada. And we're not doing the horde. If we're doing evasions, we need to make sure we're looking at the subset of empty squares that also intersect the target. Okay, so the way it's coded, the reason it's coded the way it is because in this case, target does not refer to empty squares. So we do need to look up which squares are empty. However, we need a specific destination square that blocks. So I'm not sure why in that case we'd actually need to know empty squares, but I guess it doesn't hurt to know it. That's really weird. I don't understand it, but what do I know? If we're looking for quiet checks, blah, 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 blah. So, yeah, I'm confused. Maybe I just need to go through the steps a bit more mechanically. Say bitboard 3 is equal to empty squares. If we're doing evasions, do a bitwise AND with the target. So empty squares bitwise ANDed with target versus empty squares. That really shouldn't be necessary, but apparently is. Let's first of all see if that's accurate, if that stops the error from happening. It does not stop all errors. Did it even stop the one that we saw a minute ago? I don't think so. Is this the same position? Yes, it is. So, I guess the next step is put some more assertions into the code. I mean, goodness, we know. We're pretty darn sure. Us pawn false. It's all fine. Well, actually, maybe it's not the move generator that's at fault. It's kind of a crazy. No, there's no way. It must be the move generator, because we're not doing a really deep search. We don't have any killer moves cached. It's not a matter of, oh, I've got some devastating blow that I already know I'm going to not need to generate. I mean, this... Surely, the use case must be located in, well, we don't even need depth 10, but stack dump must be occurring, not a very deep stack. Yeah, so we've started a search, and this doesn't call search too many times. We're not in the middle of some really deep search here. We're just kind of doing a one-ply search. Nothing too fancy about this at all. We don't even need to give check. Here's the move object with ID 393216. Unfortunately, that doesn't print very nicely. I mean, I could see what the move is. I guess I'm kind of forced to go there. That shouldn't be necessary, but... do I even have a way of printing a move? I think so. Wait, it's in UCI.h, right? Yeah, standard string move. Which takes a move object and a true or false value of whether or not this is chess 960. If one, we're going to print out what's the position and what's the move, which, what was it called? Move M. Whether or not this is 960, it totally is not. But here we also have to convert C++ style string into a C style string so it can print out. Please tell me that compiles. It's not declared in that scope. UCI.h is included here. Move is not declared in the scope. There it is. Standard string move, move M, bool chess 960. Why is that not in this scope? Grep W move star. Oh, UCI. I have to put it in that namespace, I guess, or however you specify that. I have to say UCI move. Then we compile that, and that should be that. Yeah, that works. Let's see, what's the move? Pawn at A1. That's the thing that's failing. Yeah, that's clearly illegal. I mean, that kind of violates everything that I put forward here. That's kind of amazing. So, in my attempt to be succinct, I've written something that's just crap. Okay, so I mean, surely empty squares. It's empty. Oh, I guess if we're generating evasions, that does address my earlier concern. So, my earlier concern is that when we're generating evasions, we can't generate a capture. So this is a way of verifying that we're not generating a capture. That's fine. I'm kind of curious why this didn't work. So there must have been some merit to the way it was previously done. Operator negative. I have a way of subtracting a square from a bit board. I have a way of subtracting a square this way. However, I did not define the subtraction operator for bitboard minus bitboard, only for bitboard minus square. Right? Operator minus. It's only defined in those two ways. If I look elsewhere. I think bitboard is not a type defined inside of types.h. Okay. So okay, well, it's loosely defined there, but certainly it does not have the negation operator I thought it had. My memory fails me. So here, rather than doing it this way, I need to do it this way. Oops, not that way, like this. Okay, that's what happens when I talk and type at the same time. So, yeah, we didn't have that kind of syntactic sugar. We have to use and then the bitwise negation operator. Yeah, if we're doing evasions, we still have to be able to place on empty squares. So this thing here still applies to our case. So this is correct, I'm pretty sure. At least it's better than what we used to have. Only took a little bit of humiliation or humility. Struggling with explaining myself as a search for this command. There's a little bit of humility involved there. All right, thanks for stopping by. Whoops. So here we have if one, disable that, prep if one everything search.cpp. Don't want to edit two files, just the one. Okay. So I've disabled all my special code that prints extra stuff. Now we're going to run the program. Again, this is only dropping pawns. I think searching to a depth of 10 or 20 or something, and that's fine. Now we're going to go back, enable this to generate any type of piece drop. Run a more complete test. Okay, that works fine. Now we're going to run the original test, which is not the start position, but is this thing with a depth of 20. And see, does this produce the same exception that we observed at the start of this process, which is like 2-some hours ago? It's altogether possible that we might not see the same error that we observed back then. Okay. Color of piece is not equal to no piece. Okay. Well, we do have an error. I don't know if this is any better or worse than the error we started with. GDB stockfish run. Okay, rerun all that stuff. Now, note that our evaluation is mate and four, so searching out beyond like eight moves is kind of, or eight half plies is kind of crazy. We're not going to find anything beyond eight half plies. We found that in this particular position, this position being this thing, with all these pieces in hand, but just imagine there's a ton of pieces in hand, that the proper continuation is knight h3, king h1, bishop g2, king takes bishop, knight drop at f4, and then pawn drop at g2. So imagine a knight dropping here, king h1, bishop dropping here, king takes bishop, knight dropping here, king going back to h1, and then pawn g2 mate. And note, if the king goes forward, there's a mate there somewhere too. If you have knights on h3 and f4, and the king goes to g3, the knight h5 is mate. So yeah, when we go, so I'm not sure. Okay, so now I should start re-enabling. But, okay, one bit of good news is that I've not seen the same error we started with. The error we started with was not that the piece is not equal to no piece. The error we started with was a stack smasher. Which means that we're reading inside the program's memory, but reading unexpected addresses, things that we'd not normally be accessing. So we have a null move. We're asserting that color of piece, no piece. Now, why are we looking at the color of piece, no piece on a null move? Type set H, position 1658. Side to move. Oh no, you've made an assumption. My goodness. Wait. Okay, so we should not have ended up in this code, is the conclusion we draw. Why would you call CGE SEE underscore GE? The static exchange evaluation of GE using a null move. Why would you do it that way at 11:27? Is there some reason to be in here? Good gravy. Our static exchange evaluator is confused by the fact that we're doing that kind of evaluation on a null move. Wait, a null move is a null move extension though, right? Have I done something stupid? Probably. But what? Extensions equal to depth zero. Extensions equal to 1 ply for extending for checks. Okay. Yeah, no, that's really confusing and possibly a defect in Stockfish itself. Probably not, given that this my code base is just like way out there, done all kinds of crazy things up above and beyond what Stockfish does. There's probably no reason for us to end up in here. But, you know, maybe somehow we did end up here and we're not supposed to. Wait, where does a null move get? How do we even generate a null move? Where does it go? What have I done? Some theories, but man, this is getting confusing very quickly. Okay, so it's not the move generator that creates the null move, it's the search function. Okay, so that's the only point in this file that uses that. Oops, I don't mean to read two files, just the one. So we don't have a transposition table hit. Then if we're performing a static evaluation, Well, you get the idea. I'm not going to be able to read and explain what this does here. Evaluation is equal to, static evaluation is equal to, last, or SS current move is not null. If it's not null, we have to do an evaluation. Otherwise, our evaluation is equal to static evaluation from 2 tempi ago. Okay, so that's one place where move null is used. Oh, here's where move null comes from. SS current move. So I'm not sure why the null move is I don't know, for one thing enabled, but for another thing why it's such a big deal. But somehow null move search is breaking this. Let's turn that back on. Let's see. Can I at least get one of those other error messages to print out? This might be it for tonight. I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to take this much further and keep up the focus I've had. It might take quite literally medication for that sort of thing. And not for a lack of effort, it's just not for any kind of deficiency, but medication can also augment a person's ability to think about things and think clearly for many hours on end, which is just crazy. Okay, so we see we got this here. And then things crapped out a bit. Like, for example, we see half the board has gone missing. Just pretty special. I'm not sure what causes that, but that's, again, pretty special. Let's get to this. And say UCI move. Whatever our move was, and then false. And then do the same thing down here. Oh, and then I have to do a C string conversion on thing move. Oh, he's already made the move. Darn it. Well, that's no good. There's no sense in printing out the move after we've made it. Because that's not going to print correctly. Well, no, actually the move object's independent of the position. It'd print just fine after we've made it. I don't know if the code's always been in that state where I've been able to do that, but currently it's in a state where I could print out the move and then print out the position, and that should work just fine. F2A5 color of piece is not equal to no piece. Yeah, and that's the other thing about debugging or troubleshooting this sort of thing, is that you might not be able to consistently reproduce exactly the same error every time. It's always a challenge with any kind of software development. Move. There we go. Let's build that again. So, oh, what did I do? 47. I do have the move here, right? Okay, I should have read that error message more carefully. I thought that it would just stand out to me what I did wrong. Apparently not. Too few arguments. Oh, to right. This needs to be told it's not playing 960. Let's recompile. Let's recompile this and then run it. Where's my... Here it is. But yeah, after the engine's found a way to win the game, it kind of freaks out and just fails to acknowledge that the game has ended. Right. Okay. So B1, A1 in this position. This may or may not be the same thing that it tried to print out earlier. B1, A1 here has just been played. Not sure why. Not sure, what does black have in hand after that? Black to move with like a queen, a rook, tons of pieces in hand. This is a different position, which for some reason... Oh, it's the same position. F2A5, B1A1. I don't see anything on F2 or on A5. F2, A5 is not legal to begin with. B1, A1. Yeah, I don't know. Things are probably out of control at this point. If it's thinking that F2, A5 just got played in there. Because there's nothing on A5. If fact, you can see that like rank 8765, the first thing on A5 is, oh, maybe a player is about to execute a move F2 A5, but that doesn't make any sense either, because that's not legal ever. So yeah, something's pretty horrifically wrong at this point in the code. So I'm thinking I just need to start adding some more assertions sprinkled everywhere throughout the code until we figure out what's going on here. What's our start position again? Is this the one? Is this where we start? And there's mate in 4. It's not even here that the mate in 4 happens. Oh yeah, it is. Knight there, or I'm sorry, knight there, bishop here, knight there, and mate follows. Be it, regardless of whether the king goes to h1 or g3. So for this whole mating sequence, it's not essential to do any pawn drops. Black's got so many bishops in hand, if I remember right. In the start position, Black has... oh, he's got one bishop and one pawn in hand. Darn it. I guess here's what we're going to do. We're going to change that start position ever so slightly. Verify that this still allows us to duplicate the error. And give Black two bishops. I mean, it's the same damn position. Just now Black has an extra bishop in hand. So he doesn't need to drop the pawn. He can drop a bishop instead. Yeah, so this duplicates the error. So now, yeah, here I was going to say, just gonna disable this for now. I don't need that there anymore, I don't think. So we're disabling all the pawn drops and seeing, does white recognize that indeed he is checkmated? Or does white keep putting up resistance because he still has a knight in hand? Maybe if I just give all white's pieces to black, in terms of pieces in hand, then this is no longer reproducible. Maybe. It's quite the conundrum. Quite the conundrum. But yeah, it should never hit depth 18, because we have a mate in 4. We totally have a mate in 4. There's no need to go so deep. So what if I change this ever so slightly? Let me keep a record of what the initial test was. It was bishop, knight, etc., etc. Here I'm changing it so black gets all the pieces. White can have some pawns. I don't care. Oh, right, I don't need to recompile just for redefining the test. So, yeah, I'm not sure why we're hitting such depths. That makes... oh, white can capture a piece in that sequence. Black drops the bishop on g2. So white does, in fact, have a bishop in hand. Gosh darn it. So white's having that bishop in hand is still problematic. So yeah, I'm gonna make a new rule here. And go back to the original position. Our new rule is gonna be kind of unfair to be true. To be just brutally honest here. We're going to say, you know, if we're playing black, we get to drop pieces. I mean, that sounds hideously unfair. So white can capture as many pieces as he wants, but only black can drop pieces on the board. Can white recognize when he's been defeated? I don't think so. Well, that's spectacular. Are you serious? What the heck? Knight h3, bishop to 2. Does black not see the checkmate or something? I think this is going to deal with the error, though, right? Oh, wait. B2, B4. What the heck? What's this position? A lot of really weird things are going on here. So B2, B4 generated something here. Well, for one, there's nothing on B2 to move to B4. Yeah, why did this get logged? Did something just move to B4, or... I don't know what happened there. Best move, F6, E4, ponder, F... Okay. That's also really weird. I mean, I've rigged the game against white, saying only black can drop things. And yet, in doing so, black is no longer dropping things. What gives? Did it not find the mate in 4 very early on? Mate 8. Mate 9. This does not make any sense. Black has a simple mating sequence. Okay. I'm going to have to revise the rules somewhat. So... we can say that if we're, yeah, and if type is not equal to evasions, then we can drop stuff. If you're evading check, dropping is now suddenly illegal. Surely it's going to find the mate here, right? Oh dear. Just why? What's going on? Is this not the simplest crazy house puzzle ever? Let's put things back to how they were and verify that we got our original result where it actually finds the mate. I mean, that mate in 4 should be kind of a slam dunk. There should be no challenge whatsoever discovering that that's mate in 4. Assuming, in fact, it is mate in 4. Oh, it's not. That's not mate in 4. Because pawn drops are illegal in this test position. I've disabled pawn drops. I have to do it this way for it actually to be a mate in 4. That's my mistake. Okay, there's the mate in 4. I was definitely losing it there for a brief moment, and that's what I mean by focus. Okay, so now does white recognize when he's defeated? And this grossly unfair game variant I just invented, where white doesn't get to drop anything. Here we still have a checkmate at depth 4. There's really no need for black to continue searching at all, because he's already found one way to checkmate. And beyond depth 4, he's not going to find anything better. Believe me, I know there's nothing better out there. And yet he keeps searching anyway. I mean, that makes very little sense. I suppose on the bright side, it's all fine. So I think this is the last thing I intended to do here. Just show off, there's a function called legal. And it defines all the rules for verifying the legality of a pseudo legal move. And I think this here is actually being really damaging. So I suspect both of these changes are quite damaging to the ability to test whether a move is legal or not, because we cannot immediately assume that all drops are legal. For example, if we're in check, we do need to verify that we're getting out of check. If type of piece on from square is equal to king, make sure that we're not castling into check. That makes sense. Make sure that we're not castling through check, etc., etc. But yeah, I think this stuff here is being detrimental. Because we can't. There are still some validations that need to be performed. I guess we can bypass this because we never drop a king. But down here, this return true is a bit aggressive. A non-king move is legal if and only if it is not pinned, or if it's moving along the way or away from the king. Wait. Where's check dealt with here? Maybe this is not overly aggressive. Maybe this is just fine. There goes my theory. Okay, so where does this function return? If we're playing anti-chess, that returns. If we're playing racing kings, that returns. Horde chess, atomic chess, this returns so many different ways. Getting that right was quite exciting. If we're dealing with an opposite move, that's not a drop. Also, if we're dealing with atomic, huh. Yeah, I'm shocked. I didn't think that this would be okay. Moving piece is a king. Check whether the destination square is attacked by the opponent. Castling moves are checked for legality during move generation. Yeah, no, I don't get it. I thought surely this would have been the thing that bail me out of there. Is there anything we need to do checking inside the pseudo-legal move generator? Oh. Oh dear. If type of move is not equal to normal, then we have to generate all the legal moves and check if it contains that move. Dear. That's amazing. I don't think we want to do that. It's saying for uncommon cases we end up there. but drops are pretty common, to be honest. So every time we're checking if a drop is a pseudo-legal move, we're generating all legal moves. That's got to be hugely expensive. Okay. If def crazy house and if type of move. Oh, hang on. For the sake of normal chess performance, we're going to do it this way. Undo. Oh, goodness. Can I delete four lines? Paste four lines. Type of move equals drop. How do I check if a move is pseudo-legal? It probably is. It's probably fine. What a mess. What a mess. Okay. Let's compile that and see what we got. Yeah, there's no reason it should be hitting depth because we have a mate in 4, but we're never going to discover anything else out there. I'm not sure what else I could do. The move printing function could use some work, for sure. Let's see, grep UCI move across all files. So where am I printing that out? Also, do I actually have a file named 2? Okay, I apparently created a file named 2 forever ago. What is this 2? Does that in any way resemble any of the other files I have? Better question. I haven't deleted any files. That's good. Diff search CPP versus 2. Okay. That was weird. Clear. Let's get back to where we were. Just here. So search CPP prints out the best move. Oh. Wait. How does this... Oh, this is how this works for Crazy House. Yeah. Okay. I was going to say this function could use some work because of the things I'm seeing get printed don't make any sense. That's not the case. This function's working just fine. It's my own code that's got some pretty serious problems somehow. Well, I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to progress beyond where we are at. Obviously, I can reduce this test to say don't look so far. and see whether or not it's capable of terminating prior to depth 10. It's going to do the full depth 10 search, even though that's not necessary. I mean, I can increase that to 14, and we'll see it goes 14, half moves deep, and still concludes this is a mate in 4. Whereas, like, with any normal chess game, you conclude that, oh, hey, the game's over, it's checkmate, you can stop searching now. For some reason, it feels a need to keep searching after that, I guess. I don't get that. At what point does that actually change? At depth 14, it still has that as the principal variation. Depth 16, yeah, it's still saying that that's best. I don't get it. Well, let's just bump this back to 20 where we started. Actually, the one other thing I could do. So let's put this back to the original test, the one where Black has to drop the pawn and then the bishop. And in that test, now that I finally got the move generator to make this unfair game, let's reintroduce pawn moves and see if that breaks anything. Again, hang on. If us is equal to black, and we're playing Crazy House. Forget, is it called Is Crazy House or Is House? It's just Is House. That's fine. Whatever. Let's recompile and redo the test. Again, only black can drop. So a5h8 is noted for some reason here. It's either a move that was just played or a move that causes some consternation. Again, there's no reason for it to even remotely be looking at anything like that, but a5h8 is not legal. Yeah, it just leaves me very confused, basically. So, I guess the other thing I could do is be a little bit more specific with these two debug statements so as not to confuse myself so much. So we're just arbitrarily going to call one of them, or have one of them print ASDF instead of test. So that's the one that got printed. A5H8 definitely does not look legal to me. And so the deal here is that there's no piece on the origin square for the move. But this is a normal move type. I don't need that elaborate condition there. So we're performing a normal move, and we don't have any piece on the origin square. Something is totally effed. That should not be possible. Oh, I wonder if that's the killer move heuristic kicking in. I wonder if recently there's... Well, I don't know. But, like, there's a concept of a killer move. In the move picker. And it'll remember moves that were recently really powerful. But I'm not sure what it would do if it remembered a drop type of move. That might be problematic. Again, this variant only black can drop pieces, but there's tons of side effects that ripple through the engine. It's just tricky to debug it all. Somehow it came up with this move, which is just not legal in any context. But maybe somehow this isn't the thing that it wants to play. Somehow this A5H8 comes out of somewhere. I'm not sure where. Okay. Well, I do need to wrap things up, so let's figure out how to do that. First of all, well, no, I can leave this no stack protector thing in the makefile. That's fine. Let's add movegen.cpp. Is there anything else that I think merits addition? Position.cpp. We can go through the rest of the... Most of this is just debugging code at this point. Yeah, I'll have to experiment with some of this. It's part of the other thing that the code author explained to me is that the hash table function's not necessarily working because it doesn't consider pieces in hand. I don't know that that's a major concern, but maybe it is. There's a lot to think through. But thing worthy of note, well, no, we're getting a different exception now. We're not getting the, this should not happen. This should abort the program right away, actually. But we're no longer getting the stack smasher error. We're getting plenty of valid errors, but not the, well, and that's probably masked. The lack of the stack smasher is probably masked by all these other errors I've started generating. Yeah, I don't know. I do not know. Well, there's the other fun thing is you can set it to print out before and after every move gets executed. And then you run it, and it just takes forever to run. But yeah, if anybody's carefully reading that, the error's somewhere in there. Just keep looking. No. I don't mean to be a jerk or anything about it, but yeah, it is somewhere in there. And just given enough time and effort, it can be found. Whatever it is that's not happening correctly. Usually don't resort to printing out this verbose output. And it even does slow down the engine, so it slows down the testing process. But yeah, somewhere in that exhaustive list of before and after positions, something is not happening correctly. And someday we will figure out why. Hope you enjoyed. Thanks for watching. Thanks for keeping company. And, I'll be playing some other game next time. This wasn't a game. This is us trying to develop, make a new Crazyhouse engine. I thought I was really onto something. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't have bothered streaming it. But, yep. No such luck. Maybe next time. Take care. Have a good day, have a good night, and see you around.